Good evening, social video stream network followers. This is Martial Arts World Radio, and I'm Joseph Clark. Thanks very much for joining us this evening. Our guests this evening are going to be Cynthia Rothrock, Lindsay Garbatt, and Jalal Merhi. So we're going to get the show kicked off in just a moment. Thanks very much for tuning in this evening, and we're looking forward to providing you with an exciting stream. By the way, on Saturday, March 25th, from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. at Phoenix Performance Center in Mount Forest, Ontario, Canada, former Cuff Flyweight World Champion Danny Beauclerk will be conducting the Leg Loch Ness Monster Seminar. Participation is only $25. Visit www.phoenixcenter.ca for more information. Once again, our guests this evening for Martial Arts World Radio are going to be guest interviews with Cynthia Rothrock, with Lindsay Garbatt, and also with Jalal Merhi. Ethan, is that Wi-Fi up yet? Let me know when it is. All right, for those just joining us, this is Martial Arts World Radio, and this is the live stream from the broadcast booth. The show's going to be kicked off in just a few minutes. We're going to have some news and weather, and then we're going to get right into the interviews for this evening. Our guests are going to be world champion Cynthia Rothrock, Lindsay Garbatt, and filmmaker Jalal Merhi. Thanks again for joining us. So once again, for those of you joining us, welcome to Martial Arts World Radio, and thank you for joining us on the social video stream, social network video stream. We're going to get the show kicked off in about 2 minutes' time. Our guests this evening are Cynthia Rothrock, Lindsay Garbatt, and martial arts filmmaker Jalal Merhi. By the way, on Saturday, March 25th, from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. at Phoenix Performance Center in Mount Forest, Ontario, Canada, former Cuff Flyweight World Champion Danny Beauclerc will be conducting the Lake Loch Ness Monster Seminar. Participation is only $25. Visit www.phoenixcenter.ca for more information.
Canada-wide warrant for 43-year-old Justin Kyre of St. Catharines. The Manitoba government is laying the groundwork for when the Trudeau government makes marijuana legal. It is moving to set restrictions on pot similar to those on alcohol. From the Canadian Press, I'm Roger Ward.
Ethan, is that Wi-Fi up?
Your hair look like you just stuck your
right in
a light socket. I wanted to feel the
power. Not up yet. Grab that door, please.
At Lessie Motors by driving our C-Max and Fusion plug-in hybrids plus the newest Focus Electric. Get a Focus Electric for $23,999. Taxes in and finance it at 0% up to 48 months. That includes $14,000 in government rebates. Energize your life with Ford's lineup of plug-in, hybrid, and all-electric vehicles. Test drive one today and let Lessie Motors Ford show you why driving electric is a smart choice.
Wesley Motors in Harrison, Walkerton, and Wingham.
Tonight, cloudy with a 40% chance of rain showers this evening, with a risk of freezing drizzle late this evening and overnight to a low of -4. For Tuesday, a mix of sun and cloud, risk of freezing drizzle early in the morning, wind out of the northwest at 40 kilometers, gusting to 60 in the afternoon, a high of 7 degrees. For Wednesday, sunshine and a high of only -5. And looking ahead to Thursday, things improve a bit. It's going to be sunny with a high of 4 degrees.
Here's what's happening at the Harrison Legion in the month of March. On Sunday, March the 19th, there's going to be a jamboree. The cost is only $5. Doors open at 12 p.m. Entertainment starts at 1 p.m. And there will be a supper served at 4:30. Musicians, singers, dancers, and spectators are all welcome. The Harrison Legion annual mini golf and steak dinner takes place on Sunday, April the 2nd. 1 p.m. is the time to start. The cost is only $20 per person. Children under 12 are $14. And there will be a steak or chicken dinner available for only $15. So come out and have some fun with friends or family, but please sign up by March the 18th. For more information, contact the Legion at 519-338-28.
The views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the participants and not necessarily those of Blue Water Radio.
Martial Arts World Radio is brought to you by Bruce County Combat and Fitness in Walkerton. Check out the full list of classes at brucecountycombat.com.
This is UFC fighter Alex Ricci. You are listening to Martial Arts World Radio with Joseph Clark.
Welcome to Martial Arts World Radio. I'm your host, Joseph Clark. Each episode, we feature many of the best fighters in the world, from the UFC, Bellator, and the Olympics, as well as martial arts legends, pioneers, and cinema stars. Over the next hour, I will feature my interviews with Hall of Fame world champion martial artist and action cinema star, Cynthia Rothrock, and WIBA World Boxing Champion turned professional MMA fighter, Lindsay Lethal Garbatt, and Kung Fu cinema star and film producer, Jalal Merhi. Martial Arts World Radio is currently seeking corporate sponsors. If you have a product or brand which you wish to promote to our 1 million global listeners weekly, reach out to me at producer@mawradio.com. Lindsay Garbatt, born September 25th, 1982, is a Canadian female fighter who transitioned from professional boxing to professional MMA. She is a former WIBA World Super Featherweight title boxing champion. She's 5'3", 123 pounds. She has a professional MMA record of 4 wins and 2 losses. 3 of her wins were by knockout or TKO. She fights out of Niagara Falls, Canada, and she trains with Bruckman Martial Arts.
Lindsay, thanks for joining us this evening.
Hi, thanks for having me.
It's always a pleasure. Lindsay, why do you fight?
Well, it may sound kind of basic, but probably the number one reason is it's fun, and I'm good at it, and I feel like it's kind of my purpose right now, and it's my outlet, and it's everything I work towards, and yeah, that's pretty much sums it up.
You know, and it's a nice feeling when you found your purpose.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I'm fortunate that I have a job that kind of, I don't have to rely on the fight game to support me, right? So I'm very fortunate in that aspect of it. So it's not definitely not about the money. I do it for me, so.
When did you start training in boxing?
I was just out of college, so I started a little bit late, but I was always in martial arts as a kid. So I did the karate thing growing up, and I always wanted to do boxing. But I was doing so many other sports that I didn't really have time for that. And then when I finally finished everything else I was doing, I started up boxing and just fell in love with it from there.
Now, Lindsay, before we go on, are there any areas for those listeners tonight who are on their devices, are there any sites, websites, or places you would like to direct them where they can see some video of you or find out more about you?
Yeah, absolutely. I have an athlete page on Facebook. I'm on Twitter at Lindsay Garb, and on Instagram, Lindsay Garbett. I'm always posting stuff. I mean, a lot of it's just funny stuff that's not really related to fight stuff, but yeah, you can follow me there.
Very good. And I noticed I'm looking at your profile that's on the SureDog site, SureDog.com.
Yep.
And it says Niagara Falls, Ontario. Do you fight out of Oshawa or Niagara Falls?
I live in Oshawa, so I fight out in Oshawa. My training camp's in Oshawa, but I grew up, born and raised in Niagara Falls, and I'm back and forth all the time, so that's my hometown.
Very good. How old were you when you began competing as a professional?
I did a few years of amateur, so I was probably about maybe 23, 24, I think.
Good age.
Yeah. Like I said, I started a little bit late, but I was busy doing other stuff.
All right, so take us back to, and we're going to move into MMA in a moment, but take us back to your very first boxing match ever. It doesn't have to be professional, but just your very first actual match against a competitor who wasn't just a sparring partner.
Yeah, my very first one, Kim Rose was my first or second, but I got knocked right out.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Kim Rose was my first or second, but they were very close to each other anyway. I had a bunch of amateur fights, but yeah, got knocked right out, and showed up the next day at the gym and just kept training.
Get that lesson out of the way early.
Yeah, that's it. Well, trust me, I learned it again a few times after that, but never stopped me.
Have you traveled to other parts of the world as a boxer?
Yeah, I was fortunate. I went to Australia, China, traveled around the States a lot. Those are probably the furthest destinations, but yeah, I've been lucky. I've definitely got some traveling under the fight game.
So on a scale of 1 to 10, when you had your first professional boxing match and your first professional MMA match, how did they compare in terms of nerves on a scale of 1 to 10?
Boxing was way, way worse. MMA was more kind of just like, finally, because I was trying so hard to get an MMA fight, and it was actually really difficult doing the crossover, finding an opponent, finally finding someone to fight that a promotion would sanction, because I had such a good boxing background. So I was training for so long for an MMA fight. So when I finally had an MMA fight, I was like, yes, finally. But when I first had my first boxing match, there was just tons of nerves there. It was in a really cool venue and family there. And yeah, it was great. But I love it. I love it.
Would you elaborate a little more on that, your first professional boxing match? Where was it, and who were you fighting? How did that play out?
Yeah, it was in Rochester at the baseball stadium there, and it was so cool. It was on, like, right on the baseball field, and it was, all open, and it was at night, and my family was there, and we were in the back, and you could sit and watch the fights that were playing out there, so it was a really nice venue. And I ended up losing that one, but it was a really good fight, close fight. And it was great.
Now, when I interviewed you last year, you were kind enough to allow me to interview you for my book that I was writing to get your perspectives on the book. And at that point, you had shared with me that MMA was a very natural feel for you, that in fact, even when you were boxing, there were times where you felt like you wanted to use your elbows or your knees. So perhaps you could talk to us a little bit about that.
Yeah, for sure. And congratulations again on the book.
Thank
awesome.
You.
Yep. And, you know what? Like I said, it was always something that I wanted to do. I wrestled in high school. Like I said, I did karate. So I always just had that in the back of my mind that I had to do it, and I just wasn't getting any younger, and I just felt like I had to make that switch. And then when things started slowing down in boxing, and I was having trouble finding other people to fight, and I felt like I kind of accomplished what I was going to accomplish, I finally made the switch. So.
And does one feel more natural than the other in terms of competing?
I don't know about that. Good question, but I don't know about that. I feel like maybe MMA is more of a challenge to me now because I feel like I'm always learning so much. With boxing, I felt maybe like, you know, you plateau a bit in it for so long. I mean, you can always learning, of course, but MMA, some stuff I feel like a total rookie when it comes to some stuff. In that aspect, yeah, it's definitely, you know, it's just a new challenge, and I like the challenge. I like, you know, to be tested.
In your opinion, and this will obviously differ when we speak to, different guests, but in your opinion, is it more advantageous for somebody to have a wrestling background who then becomes a striker, or for somebody who's a striker who then learns the technicalities of grappling and wrestling?
That's something that we can kind of talk about forever or argue about, but I don't know. I mean, styles make fights too, so I guess it depends who you were fighting, but I don't know. I feel like I had a good base, and I like the way that I transferred over. I like having the stand-up background and then learning more of the ground stuff, the way it worked out for me. If I had to do it the other way around, I don't know. I think it's hard to say. I think maybe that would be more challenging. But I don't know. I kind of just took to it, and it kind of comes natural. But it's a good question, and a lot of people will give you a lot of different answers, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's probably going to be an ongoing debate forever.
Yeah, totally.
Lindsay, share with us how you must have felt the emotion when you won your championship title.
Oh, man. Well, it's funny because I did have a lot of good shots, and I fought no doubt the best in the world, and I lost a lot. If you look at my boxing record, I lost a lot, but I had a lot of tough fights, and I mean, a lot of them I don't even know if you can find online or anything like that. But I feel like I worked hard towards it. I have good shots, but I kind of, you know, I came close, but I failed, and then when I finally won my world title, I was just like, it was like, I finally accomplished what I wanted to accomplish, and I didn't want to stop there. I felt like I had a lot more to do, and you know, I wish I could have had more fights. And it kind of slowed up, and I was having trouble finding fights, and that's why MMA kind of came around at a good time for me. And
yeah, I'm hearing you as well.
But I mean, I cherish those moments. I cherish, you know, I have my family with me.
Yeah.
And I have my belt in my living room still, I don't take anything for granted that I learned in the boxing world, that's for sure.
Well, congratulations on that fight career. That is wonderful, and that must be such an inspiration when you look at those belts.
Thank you. Yeah, it is, but it drives me to work hard because I want to do the same thing in MMA, so.
When did you transition to mixed martial arts?
It would have been, well, I was, like I said, I was trying for a couple of years. I was training for a couple of years before I actually made the switch. So it's about 5 years, I would say. And then I ended up doing another boxing fight kind of in the transition. And then after that, I finally had my first fight a couple of years ago. So yeah, so it was a long transition. It was frustrating, and there were times when you just kind of wanted to, like, okay, should I give up? Should I pack it in? Like, is this going to happen for me? Not getting any younger, but, yeah, I stuck it out. I mean, I have a great team, and was learning a lot, so, and I'm having fun, so.
Okay, so at what age did you become a professional boxer?
Yeah, like I said, I think it was 24.
24?
Yeah, 24, 25, I think.
Okay, and then at what age did you become a professional MMA fighter? Because I imagine you fought amateur, did you, before you became?
No, I didn't. I couldn't get, I wouldn't get sanctioned because of my professional background.
Oh, of course, because of your professional boxing background.
Which was great, because I didn't want to do an amateur fight anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, it would have been, my first fight was just a couple years ago.
Okay.
So I was like 30, 31.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I know when I look on the web, which, you know, the web, you have different stories coming up at different websites. Some of them had you, 32, 33. And so you never know what to believe in terms of age and weight and all of that stuff. But
yeah.
So you're in your early 30s. You're 5'3".
I'm 33.
Okay, 33, 5'3". Your fighting weight then is 115?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So you fight at 115 when you're not fighting. And you're not at fight weight. What weight would you normally? These are questions you don't normally ask ladies. How old are they and how much do they weigh? This is probably the only place where I can get away with this. But what weight would you normally be at when you're not fighting?
Oh yeah, trust me. I don't care at all. I get those questions all the time, and I'm totally open with it. Yeah, usually like 130, 135. I was coming off an ACL injury, so I probably got up to about 135.
About 135. All right. Do you find it challenging to cut weight? Some people do, some people not so much.
No, actually, no. I think I finally kind of, trust me, it's a lot of trial and error, and I think we finally got it down that I feel awesome after I cut weight, and it's definitely a difficult process. I mean, I've been writing everything down that I eat for the past 4 months. After I blew my knee out, I had ACL surgery, and I was, everything I did every day, I was writing down, making sure that I kept everything in check. Mm-hmm. And now, we're just starting the fight camp process, and it'll be no problem.
How did you blow your knee out?
Sparring.
Mm-hmm.
Sparring. It was a heartbreaker, because I had a fight contract signed, and I was ready to fight out west, and just blew it in training camp. That's the way she goes. But
and it's such a challenge, right, to stay in shape when you're recovering from an injury.
Yeah, it was definitely the most mentally tough thing that I had to deal with these last couple years. That was definitely hard. I mean, it's only been 4.5 months. I'm killing it. I knew as soon as I had it done, I was like, I'm going to blow this out of the water. I'm going to come back as fast as I can and do everything I could possibly can. I mean, I have an awesome team behind me that I've been getting great care. And yeah, and I feel great. I'm just really eager to get back in there.
And in terms of your fight record as a mixed martial artist, is it 3-1?
3-1.
3-1. Okay. Why did you make the transition from boxing to martial arts?
For the challenge, I wanted to challenge myself, and I felt like I would be an exciting fighter in MMA, and I feel like I can go far. And, well, I know I'll go far, and I just, like I said, I always had that in the back of my head. I had that little bit of background, and I wanted to learn new things. And I am, and I love the team that I'm with, and I'm just learning so much, and I just want to have a good, I've got a few good years left in me, so I want to have a good go at it.
I have no doubt you've got lots of great years left in you. And how is MMA different from boxing? Is it more complicated?
I wouldn't say more complicated. I think maybe just for me, it's just because I'm learning so many new things. I'm just challenging myself It's very, I think, it's actually less maybe mentally, boxing was more mentally challenging, I think, because you would do a lot of the same thing all the time, if you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, the training would be a lot of the same. Now, I mean, maybe I was a little bit more old school back then, too, when I was training for boxing, but now, with the team that I have now,
Lindsay's
I'm just,
instructor.
We're just, like, we're just, there's so much different things I'm doing. With the strength and conditioning, everything, the gym that I'm at, I just feel like it's top-notch, and everything's just going great.
Lindsay's instructor, Justin Bruckman, is another guest of Martial Arts World Radio. He fought George St. Pierre and David Loiseau early in their careers. In fact, Lindsay is a boxing instructor at Justin's facility in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada, Bruckman Martial Arts. You've been listening to my interview with Lindsay Garbatt. Bruce County Combat and Fitness in Walkerton offers recreational and competitive kickboxing and boxing classes for children and adults, as well as yoga classes. Your first class is always free to try. Bruce County Combat and Fitness offers single monthly memberships for as low as $45 and $67 for a family. Their drop-in fees are only $7 for most classes and just $5 for yoga and little warriors. Check out their full schedule at brucecountycombat.com. Find them on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. They also sell a full range of fight gear and apparel.
Dawn, these winter days are getting me down. Well, here's something that might cheer you up. Ford just announced that they are Canada's best-selling automotive brand for 8 years in a row.
That is great news. Makes sense with all the great vehicles we have to choose from.
F-150, Escape, Edge, Focus, just to name a few. All with great offers from Ford. And don't forget about our Leslie Motors no-charge 2-year 40,000-kilometer maintenance plan.
Thanks, Dawn. I feel better.
That's good, because it's time to move some more snow.
Crap.
Check out LeslieMotors.com for all the details.
Leslie Motors in Harrison, Walkerton, and Wingham.
Tired of hard water wreaking havoc around your home? Dry skin and lifeless hair? Dull and dingy laundry? Soap scum and spotted glasses too?
Hey, Culligan man! A Culligan water softener turns hard water soft every time. Soft water is the answer. Not cleaning products or detergents. Culligan saves you up to 50% on soaps and detergents while turning your laundry, bathroom, and kitchen brilliant, like me.
Hey, Bob, check this out. Shaking and dumping these minnows down the ice hole will really attract those big fish we're after.
Yo, Joe, that's illegal. You can't dump live minnows. You could introduce invasive species or spread disease. Man, this lake has been our favorite fishing place since we were kids. Is it worth risking it all?
The Ontario Federation of Anglers and Hunters and the Ministry of Natural Resources remind anglers it is illegal to release live bait into any water body. Help keep our lakes great. Visit invadingspecies.com for more information.
Martial Arts World Radio is brought to you by Bruce County Combat and Fitness in Walkerton. Check out the full list of classes at brucecountycombat.com. Bruce County Combat and Fitness in Walkerton offers recreational and competitive kickboxing and boxing classes for children and adults, as well as yoga classes. Your first class is always free to try. Bruce County Combat and Fitness offers single monthly memberships for as low as $45 and $67 for a family. Their drop-in fees are only $7 for most classes and just $5 for yoga and little warriors. Check out their full schedule at brucecountycombat.com. Find them on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. They also sell a full range of fight gear and apparel.
Hi, I'm Bob Wall, a World Full Contact Karate Champion, and I'm the co-star of Enter the Dragon. You're listening to Martial Arts World Radio with Joseph Clark.
Martial Arts World Radio connects with audiences through distinctive and compelling guests and content across radio, online, and mobile platforms. If you would like to add your station to our network, or if you would like to advertise on the show and sponsor our celebrity fighter interviews, reach out to me at producer@mawradio.com. This week's inspirational quote is from retired baseball star Derek Jeter and goes as follows. There may be people who have more talent than you, but there's no excuse for anyone to work harder than you do. Retired baseball star Derek Jeter. For those of you on your devices, check out the website www.bobwallworldblackbelt.com, the world's foremost martial arts online community, and everything MMA and martial arts web store. On Saturday, March 25th, from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. at Phoenix Performance Center in Mount Forest, Ontario, Canada, former Cuff Flyweight World Champion Danny Beauclerc will be conducting the Leg Loch Ness Monster Seminar. Participation is only $25. Visit www.phoenixcenter.ca for more info. Jalal Merhi began his martial arts training in Taekwondo, then added Shotokan Karate and Hungar-style Kung Fu to his repertoire. He was a competitor in the forms and weapons circuit and eventually organized his own competitions. Jalal sold his jewelry business to start his own independent film studio, which led to his starring and producing close to 30 films from 1991 to 2015. He has starred opposite Cynthia Rothrock, Billy Blanks, Bolo Jung, Olivier Gruner, and David Bradley, to name but a few. Among his films are Tiger Claws, The Circuit, Sudden Death, Expect No Mercy, and Expect to Die.
Jalal, beginning with the end in mind, what current projects are you embarked on?
We're doing right now the conspiracy show. We're in our third season in Canada and our first season in the U.S. with Discovery in the U.S. It's called Destination America Channel, owned by Discovery. And we deal with all kinds of conspiracies. I produce and direct this show, and my company, Film One, produces the product.
Terrific. Congratulations. And how many television series has Film One produced so far?
This is the second one that runs into multi-season. So we have now approximately 45 episodes of that. And we did another one with Fox at the U.S. It's called Soccer Dreams. I also produce and direct that one. But also we've done a lot of documentaries recently. But right now I'm focusing quite a bit on TV, since it keeps the production always constant.
How many films has Film One produced?
We've done around, I think, 21.
21 films.
Yeah.
And how many years in the business exactly?
We started our first project in 89, and it took us, first project took the longest, it took us till 91, but since then, so I would say 25, this is our 25th year.
And I mean, that is very exceptional for an independent film company in Canada to produce so many films, be in business for so long, and produce series as well for television. That's very active.
It's different than the way other people do it. That's the main reason why we're still around. And also, before I came to this business, I was a businessman too. I had a chain of jewelry stores and a manufacturer. So I deal with it as a film business, just the way it sounds. I don't deal with it only as an artist. So you gotta separate both. And if you deal with it as a film business and at the same time hire the right artist to do the artistic part, you should be able to survive. Plus you have to learn about the distribution. That's the key part, is distribution.
And would you say that your approach to film production as a business is unorthodox?
I would say totally. Different than what everybody else planned it, and different what anybody else has done before. What we did, we did not rely on any Canadian or telefilm. For our 20 films, we never went or tried or qualified for telefilm funding. But what we got is international distribution. We built an international market more than anybody else. And this is the way I've always did it. And that's the reason why I'm still in business too, because if you want to wait for somebody to approve your product or to approve your application, sometimes you could go out of business before.
Would you be able to name some of the stars you've worked with?
You're thinking right now people who might know, from David Carradine to James Hong to from Canada, many Canadians that are well known that are there, David Bradley, Billy Blanks, Bolo Jung from Enter the Dragon with Bruce Lee, he's the big guy there,
Al Waxman in Canada, and many, many others. Just you've worked with me on a couple of films, so you should know some of them too.
So Bolo Jung, for example, of course, I believe one of the first films that I caught that you produced many, many moons ago was Tiger Claws.
Yes.
And I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, I think Bolo was in Tiger Claws.
Yes, he was. Definitely. I mean, Tiger Claws 1 is very close to my heart. It's my second film, although it came out first, because my first film I was not able to release, although Cineplex in Canada bought it, but I was not able to release. But the second film, Tiger Claws, is the one that gave me notoriety worldwide, and the Universal Studios picked it up and ordered four more of the same.
Yeah.
And the moment Universal picked it up, everybody followed. They do like to, you know, first you need the big boys to do it, and if they do it, people feel that, you know, this must be good. Otherwise, why would Universal touch it? Tiger Claws is very close to my heart. I mean, although looking at it right now, I say, well, you know what, I could have done this, could have done that, but it's a classic worldwide.
And when we say the big boys picked it up, you're talking theatrical release, correct?
Yes, we did get the theatrical release, definitely in many, many countries all over the world. And also a great, at that time it was VHS release, we were a great VHS release, it was everywhere.
Something that I find interesting here, Bolo Jung, for example, as a co-star, as you mentioned, Bolo Jung acted opposite Bruce Lee in Enter the Dragon. He acted opposite Jean-Claude Van Damme in Bloodsport. This is no small name when it comes to an internationally recognized star for a martial art film.
Bolo's an amazing person, as a person himself. He's very spiritual. He's a great martial artist. I met him in Hong Kong, actually, at Jackie Chan's place. And while I was doing my first film, and he was very helpful in everything. I mean, he made things easy. He's quietly wise on the side, and I benefited a lot from his knowledge. And same time, he respects people who are trying. He knew that I was new, and but he liked the vision I had. And he gave me the best he could give for the days we had him here. So it worked out well.
Now, there's an origin story, I believe, to your entry into the film business and to Film One. And that story is that you had a family jewelry business or an extension of your family jewelry business. And I believe you sold it in order to finance the company or at least finance your production. Could you share that story with us?
I mean, the film business I built in Toronto, in Canada, and mainly in Toronto and suburb, was something I built on my own. My family, the film business we had, the jewelry business we had, is based in Brazil mainly, where I was born originally. But I came in here alone, and I wanted to be alone. Always I was independent. I wanted to prove I could do it on my own. So I built up a nice film business, and apparently I must have served a niche that was missing in the market, and we did Wholesale to Republic, that was set up, and we did very well. But I studied film initially, and I always loved film. So I'm the type of person that if I'm not very excited about what I do, I can't do it. So I changed my business the moment I felt that it's time to move on. And everyone thought I was crazy, but I actually turned around, sold my share in a building downtown Toronto, sold my stores, my merchandise, put all the money together, and bought a studio in Donlands and East York, old theater, turned it to a studio, invested a lot of money in it, and that's it. I never looked back since.
And so you purchased the Donlands Theater, the movie theater.
Yes.
And that became your headquarters for Film One, your film studio.
Yes, for 11 years.
And I believe the Donlands Theater also was a location for some of your films.
Oh, definitely. I mean, the interior we turned into a studio. We used the exterior a couple of times, so it doesn't, you know, we don't want to use it all the time, but from the back or the front, it had a very good character to it. So it was a location. And it's a place that actually has other history too, that that place, I mean, other Canadian celebrities actually worked there as ushers from East York. I'm not going to go into that right now. So the place had great vibes to it.
Jalal, you are a martial artist.
Yes.
And would you share with us how you got your start in martial arts and what style of martial art you studied?
I started at age 11. My brother was doing Taekwondo, and so I was learning from him. Then I wanted to go and learn myself, but where we were living, there was no, where we moved that year, by the time I was 15, there was no Taekwondo place, so I went into Karate JKA, so I learned Japanese Karate, and I got into brown belt with that. Then I moved to Toronto, and in Toronto I met some people, as just first year I was here, first few months, 2 months, I met some people, they were jogging in Hyde Park, and they had Kung Fu written on their t-shirts, and to me, my dream was always Kung Fu, thinking of Bruce Lee. So I chased them, I ran after them, and I chatted with them, and I joined their Kung Fu club, and that's where I really excelled, because I had the base, and Kung Fu was my dream, and mainly how to use ancient weapons, and that's how I excelled in martial arts. To me, when I do something, I like to give it my all, and I did give it my all, and it's been good since then. I mean, I've done very well in the tournament circuit at that time. You're talking about, you know, the late 70s, early 80s, and eventually I had my own tournament where people came in, and I gave as a prize a diamond ring, which nobody was giving. Usually people were giving just trophies. So I had an amazing turnout by big stars. And one of them is Billy Blanks, the Taipo guy, or Nasty Anderson, Toki Hill. Some of the top world martial artists from the U.S. were coming up too, because of the prize and the money that we're getting.
And Billy Blanks, of course, starred in, I believe, at least one of your films, or did he star in more than one?
Three of them. I gave him his first starring roles, actually. And second and third, Talons of the Eagle, first starring role, TC 2000, and then Expect No Mercy. And since then, he's done very well for himself. And, you know, worked together with him on other things. We're still working. I was with him last week in California, and we're trying to do something else, too, right now.
Do you have any martial arts idols of your own?
As a martial arts person, I believe in the artistic part of martial art. Not just, you know, put them in the corner and smack their head till blood comes out. I cannot watch those type of martial art. So Bruce Lee is an artist, was an artist, and is an idol to me, looking at his moves, looking the way he worked out. So I think he's the one that I looked up to most.
And did you cast yourself in all of your productions, or do you have productions that you've produced where you were not in front of the camera?
No. To me, initially I did. Initially I was cast by somebody else. That's how I turned the corner. How I got into, you know, sometimes you need a little notch. Mm-hmm. I was in a tournament where I won the Grand Championships, I would say in mid-80s, I think it was. And a producer walked into me, but you know, at the end of the tournament, and asked me if I'd be interested to be in films. To me, it was like, what? What is this? So it was something, a dream came through. And he told me who he is. He was a known producer. And then I was training with him for a while. But that film itself, after training for a few months, like many films, sometimes they just, he couldn't get the final funding for it. He had half the money. So it just was falling apart. So I told him, meet me in my office downtown, let's chat. He came to my office. That's when he realized I had money. First he thought I'm just a martial artist, didn't know I had a jewelry business. And like a typical producer, now he's asking me to put some money in film business. So this is how gradually, I did not end up putting money with him right away, but I did spend money with him and pay his tickets to travel to LA, but I said, if I go with you. And that's how I start getting to meet people. I actually bought my way into it by paying to him. because I didn't want to jump into anything blindly. But since then, I would say after the first 11 or 12, I stopped being in the films myself. Sorry, I have 13 that I'm starring in. The rest, I'm not. It's just I felt more comfortable being behind the camera than in front of it. Just because of my family, mainly. I have kids, and things changed in my life.
What was the motivation to get into film?
Producer, yes. Actor, I never saw myself, but when somebody else picked me, so suddenly I think certain ego gets in the way and start, you know, plays a role. And then when Universal picked up a film I was in, so now there's a reason to be there.
Jalal has competed in over 150 tournaments, and he remains a prolific film and television producer today. This has been a discussion with martial artist, entrepreneur, and filmmaker Jalal Merhi.
This is Emily from La Dame Reflections in Durham. La Dame Reflections, this area's newest women's clothing and accessory destination. We stock 75% Canadian-made brands with exciting designs, all at fabulous prices. Visit us as we approach our first anniversary. Right now, our clearance sale is on, with exciting spring and summer fashions arriving soon. Visit Lisa or I at La Dame Reflections in Durham, 119 Garifraxa Street South. We'll make you look great,
so you'll feel fabulous.
Income tax stressing you out? Let Bill Brown's Income Tax take the worry out of tax time for you. Simply drop off your information at their office. Bill and his qualified staff will gladly process and e-file your return. For seniors living in Hanover, they offer free pickup and delivery of returns for your added convenience. Call 519-364-3236 or drop in today at 667 10th Street, Hanover. Office hours are Monday to Friday, 9 to 6, and Saturday, 9 till 5. Bill Brown's Income Tax in Hanover, three doors down from Tim Hortons, 519-364-3236.
Martial Arts World Radio is brought to you by Bruce County Combat and Fitness in Walkerton. Check out the full list of classes at brucecountycombat.com. Martial Arts World Radio is brought to you by Bruce County Combat and Fitness in Walkerton. Check out the full list of classes at brucecountycombat.com.
Hi, this is Keith Vitale, and you're listening to Martial Arts World Radio with Joseph Clark.
She was the first woman to appear on the cover of a martial arts magazine. CYNTHIA ROTHROCK, born March 8, 1957, is an American martial artist and action cinema star. She holds black belt rankings in seven styles of martial arts. She was five-time world champion in forms and weapons between 1981 and 1985. These categories are not combat-oriented, being displays of fluidity of movement rather than fighting, and are therefore not segregated into male and female categories, but fully open to both sexes. She took first place in forms 32 times, and first place in weapons 12 times in her first 38 tournaments, including competing in men's forms 3 out of 4 times, as there was no women's division. She was grand master of 5 tournaments and came in first place in 4 out of 5 fighting events. She holds 7 black belts in various Far Eastern martial disciplines, including Tang Soo Do, Taekwondo, Eagle Claw, Wushu, Northern Shaolin, and Pai Lum Tao Kung Fu. She received her 6th degree black belt in Tang Soo Do Mu Duk Kwan in 2006. She was tested by Grandmaster Robert Kowalewski, 9th Dan and chair of the ITMA, and was later promoted by him to 7th degree black belt in 2011 and 8th degree black belt in 2015. CYNTHIA has starred in over 50 film and television programs. CYNTHIA, welcome and thanks for joining us.
Oh, thank you.
CYNTHIA, I could open this interview any number of ways. However, let's begin with your origin story.
Oh, okay. Well, I was born in Wilmington, Delaware. I grew up in Scranton, Pennsylvania. I moved to California, then I moved to Hong Kong for 3 years, and then down to Southern California.
Very good. And you're just outside of Los Angeles now, correct?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And at what age did you get into martial arts?
I started when I was 13.
At age 13, and what was the motivation?
My girlfriend's parents were studying Tung Sido, and they owned a health club, and we would go down there while they were, like, cleaning the equipment, and they would practice when they got done, and I watched it, and I said, oh, that's kind of cool. I first that caught my eye was they were orange belts, but they had a belt and a karate uniform, and I was thinking, oh, that might be kind of fun. I think I'd like to give that a try.
Those are good colors. What style did you begin with then?
I started with Tung Sido, Korean karate, at the Scranton Karate School under Master Frank Chinovich.
Oh, terrific. And then what styles have you, would you say that was your foundation style? Like, do you have one style in particular that you would say is your main foundation?
Oh, definitely. Yeah, I think when anybody does martial arts, their first style is their ground foundation.
And what styles have you incorporated since?
Well, from studying Tung Sido, I then went on to learn Pai Lum Kung Fu, and then Eagle Claw Kung Fu, and then Wushu, and then Taekwondo. So, and now I'm studying Chen Tai Chi. So it's, you know, martial arts, you can keep on learning, like, for your whole lifetime.
It is a journey, isn't it?
It sure is.
Tell us about your very first competition. Was it forms in kata? Or did you do point or full contact?
Well, my very first competition, I was an orange belt, and it was in open hand form. And at that point, we were competing in all ranks. So it was women. It was just women. So you had white belts and black belts. And I ended up taking second place. Black belt took first. Black belt took third. So at that point, I thought, well, if I really practice, if I could do this as an orange belt, maybe I could be really
right now,
good at this sport. So that kind of started me to practice really, really hard, because then my goal became, I want to be the best in this sport.
And did you have anybody as a role model who was encouraging you to go in that direction, or was this all coming from internally, from within you?
No, it came internally. I started competing more, and then I started winning more, and then I went into a professional competition and won that, and everybody was saying, oh, well, you have to move to the West Coast, and before I did that, I was studying in New York, and actually my role model was kind of Jackie Chan, because my teacher, Sifu Shum Leung, he used to take us to Chinatown after class, and I would go to New York from Scranton every Sunday to train with him. And I would see Jackie Chan movies. So I would kind of go home, and I would imitate his moves. And I just loved, you know, the way that he moved. And I think I just, you know, it was my love for martial arts. Different things, like, caused me, you know, actually the movies was just by accident. I really didn't think that was something that I wasn't thinking of. Oh, this is what I want to do. My main focus at that time was to be undefeated for 5 consecutive years. And that was like basically competing maybe 30 times a year. So it wasn't like some people would, you know, they fight or they compete once a year and then decide to defend my titles and I won. This is like probably over, you know, all those times, way over hundreds of tournaments that I competed in.
That's an intense schedule, too, to be doing 30 competitions a year.
Oh, it was. You know, it was probably more than that, because I just kind of remember I would be going like almost every weekend, because if there was especially when I was on the East Coast, if there was a competition, I would take all the eastern states and go. I mean, I just loved it. And, you know, it's the first time I've ever won anything, so I was so proud. You know, my mom was like, oh, my gosh, my daughter got a trophy. When she saw the first trophy, it was out for everybody to see. You know, after about the 30th trophy, they started getting put away.
There's only so much room in the house.
And now they're in my mom's basement. I have about 1,000 of them in my mom's basement. And she keeps saying, and she's in Pennsylvania, she keeps saying, and can I get rid of them? And I'm like, no, you can't get rid of them. And it's like, I can't take them, so I don't know what to do with them. So they're there.
Cynthia, so you competed as an amateur in forms, and you've mentioned that you went to professionals. So this may sound like a bit of a shallow question, but I'm legitimately curious about this. Is there money to be made in forms and weapons competition?
Well, at that time, There was, and it was $125 every time you took first place. And then if you won the grand champion, then maybe you got like $250. But the promoter would pay for your expenses, fly you out. And at that point, that was like huge for me. It's like, wow, we're at $125. You know, I remember my dad, I was just saying, why don't you take up tennis? You'd be making a lot more money.
That's right. But this is the promoters flying you out. And did you get sponsorships as well?
No, I didn't. Actually, I didn't really need them because my expenses were getting paid. And then, you know, I'd win forms and I'd win weapons. And, you know, so I'd be going home with, like, you know, $250. And I was a happy camper.
That's right. Yeah. And I mean, the fact that you're doing something that you love. And this is, on top of having to be a terrific athlete, to be agile and flexible and have the stamina and endurance to do this kind of competition, this is a performance competition. I mean, this is when I've watched Forms and Weapons, it's incredibly impressive. The choreography is beautiful, and there's so much interpretation, and there's so much personalization, right, to everybody's style. So how can the judges actually judge this fairly?
Well, you know, it's actually quite easy because a kick is a kick no matter what style you're doing it. You know, speed, power, the things you look for, concentration, focus, you know, does the person really look like they're fighting someone or do they look like they're just doing a bunch of moves? So you don't technically have to know that. You just know the basics. And when you're a judge, you know, you have to be at least a black belt. And when you're in the black belt competitions, they have the high masters. So it doesn't matter what you're doing. If you're a proficient martial artist and you're above, you know, first degree black belt, you should be able to judge anything because you know what to look for.
So when you were at the peak of your career, were you finding that you were coming up against the same competitors at that level? Like, was it usually filtering down to the same three or four or five competitors?
Well, I've been doing it for 5 years. I had a goal. I wanted to do it 5 years, and then I wanted to retire because I wanted to retire number one, and I figured that was a record, you know, competing at least, you know, 30 times a year. Nobody really could break. And, you know, when I first started, you know, it was the same people, and then you get new people coming in, and then the third year you get new people coming in, you know, and it was tough because everybody was out, you know, to get me because at that point after, you know, being undefeated, you know, in forms, that was the thing, is to beat CYNTHIA ROTHROCK. So I went to China to study for 8 weeks. I went to Taiwan. I went to Hong Kong. So I was constantly trying to learn more and more moves because each year, someone would come out that would say, ooh, they could do this. And I'd go, oh, my gosh, now I got to do something better. You know, so you had to keep the game going and, you know, strive higher and higher for more difficulty as the years went on.
Well, that was going to be my next question, which was over time, just, you know, by nature, did it become more complex? Did it become more fancy and more technical over time?
Oh, yeah, definitely, because I had to keep improving because, you know, martial artists kept improving, and then they'd go, what is CYNTHIA doing? Oh, how could I do that better? And then I'd be like, okay, well, now that they're trying to do this, I got to do this, you know, and it was a little stressful because, you know, toward the last year, I was doing such difficult moves, it didn't matter, you know, how really good you were. It's like, you know, I'd be doing these extreme balance movements that required strength, and if I was like I remember one time I was on a tarp and I was on a wrinkle, and the wrinkle was trying to throw me off balance, but I knew if I slid just a little bit, that would give the judges something to say, oh, you know, so-and-so did better than CYNTHIA. So I remember I used to do this move where I'd hold my leg up and touch, you know, my toes to my head. And I was on the wrinkle, and my foot just stayed there. I couldn't hold my foot because I was thinking of the wrinkle, and I just knew that if I messed up, I wouldn't win. So it's funny, like, how your mind kind of goes, oh, you got to do this. You know, if you asked me to hold my leg with my toes touching to my head without pushing it with my hand, I wouldn't be able to do it. But, you know, in that case, like, if I don't do it, I'm going to lose, you know. So I was glad when I retired because I was like, whew, finally did that.
How did you manage the nerves and the stress of that expectation that's placed on you as being a consistent champion over and over and over again, and that expectation that you're going to continue to up the ante in the performance and the technicality of the movements?
Yeah, you know, it was really stressful because it got to the point after I was, like, undefeated for 3 years, and then, you know, more girls were coming out, and they were getting better and better, and I was like, oh, my gosh, if I lost, what am I going to do? It'd be such big news. CYNTHIA ROTHROCK loses, you know? So I, and, you know, nerves, I was always nervous. I was not the kind of person that could go in and say, I got this, it's a piece of cake. I'd be, like, running to the bathroom, like, 10 times. You know, I would constantly be going through my moves in my head. I wouldn't really talk to people. And then my nerves would hit me just until I got up and started my routine. Then all the nerves left. Then I got into the zone, into the moment. You know, I was just right into my form. And then after that, when I won, then it was like, oh, gosh, now I could relax, you know. Now I could go eat a dish of pasta or something, and I could go talk to everybody.
How did Hollywood find you?
Well, interesting. I was on the West Coast demonstration team out of Northern California, and there was a Hong Kong company looking for a guy. They wanted to find a new Bruce Lee. And it didn't have to be Chinese. It could be any kind of race. They were just looking for someone to take that spot. And they contacted Ernie Reyes because he was the team leader, and we were, like, known to be, like, you know, the cream of the crop. And they said, well, should we bring the girls? And they're like, yeah, you can bring them, but we're looking for a guy. So I went down, and Yoon Kwei, Corey Yoon, who's, you know, he's my favorite director, and also he's, you know, he's done really big movies like Transporter and stuff. He was there doing the auditions, and he went, and he said, I'm going to pick the girl over a guy. So that's actually how I got started. Went off to Hong Kong and did my first movie.
By the way, do Chinese arts dominate forms and weapon competition?
No, actually Chinese did not. At that time, it was more art style. The Chinese style, even today, there's still more hard stylists than Chinese stylists. And I think maybe that has to do with the fact that, you know, the Korean styles and, you know, the Japanese styles were over here in America longer before a lot of the Chinese styles were, like, underground, or they were teaching out of, you know, basements. It wasn't really a commercial, as commercial as the other styles. So, the minority has always been the Chinese styles.
Now, CYNTHIA, I'm all over the board here, jumping back and forth between film career and competitive career, but you've starred in over 30 martial art films. Would you share some of the places in the world which your film career has taken you?
Oh, my gosh. Okay, well, I filmed in Nepal, which was kind of cool.
Very cool.
Taiwan. I filmed in Indonesia. I filmed in Australia. Let's see, where else did I film? Let's see, as far as other countries, I think that's about it. Filmed a lot in L.A. So it did take me to some really, really cool places, especially like Indonesia.
When you did your films with Jalal Merhi, who, by the way, I'm featuring one of my interviews with Jalal today, like Tiger Claws and other films, were they shot in Toronto?
Actually, they were, yeah. So Canada, took me to Canada. Yeah, I did three of those with Jalal, and we shot them all in Toronto.
In your opinion, you know, having worked with Asian directors, and I imagine Asian film choreographers as well, versus North American. Comment, if you would please, on the quality of the fight choreography on the Asian films versus the North American films. Are they better? Are they about the same? Is it consistent?
Well, it's a different style. You know, in most of your, like, American-based films, you know, you'll do one or two punches or kicks, but in Chinese movies, you'll be doing, like, a 20-minute fight scene, you know, jumping off roofs, you know, doing flips, being on wires. It's a totally different style. Some people don't like that. Some people do. I love it. I love to do that because, to me, it's a lot more difficult to do, and that's how I like to move. But giving actually all the films that I've done, when I shot American films, they were all done very fast. I think the longest I ever did was a 6-week film. So we didn't have much time. We didn't have much time to focus on the fight scene. Like, you'd get 20 minutes maybe to do the ending fight scene. In Hong Kong, a movie I did, Yes, Madam, which was my first one, the ending fight scene took 1 month. So that whole movie took 7.5 months. So if you have that much time to rehearse and shoot and do everything, of course it's going to be more amazing, you know, as compared to, you know, doing a 15-day shoot. Like the last film I just did, Martial Art Kid, you know, we shot that in like 15 days. So you don't have the time to really, really, you know, do that compared to what you see in a Hong Kong movie.
Yeah, I see a lot of the Hong Kong movies, the fights are a very rich part of the story. It's almost like a ballet.
Yeah, Yeah, it's almost like this. There's not a story, just fights. You look at it and you want to see all the fights.
Cynthia is also a martial arts instructor. She has been inducted into numerous Hall of Fames. And in 1983, she was inducted into the Black Belt Magazine Hall of Fame as Female Competitor of the Year. In 2014, she was honored with the Legacy Award at the Urban Action Showcase and Expo at HBO. This has been an interview with Cynthia Rothrock. Be sure to check us out at www.mawradio.com. And follow us on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and YouTube by following Martial Arts World Radio. I'm Joseph Clark. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much for tuning in, our social network video stream viewers, and we'll be back next Monday at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for more Martial Arts World Radio.
Water Radio News is brought to you by your Hanover...